Welcome to a special Crime Watch behind the scenes. This month, instead of asking you for information, we're coming back to you with news.
This is a chance to show the sometimes extraordinary chain of events that follows calls to Crime Watch. Stories that can't usually be told because inquiries are so sensitive or court cases are pending.
It's the big reconstructions that define the programme, but our short appeals often have big stories behind them too. In November 97, we carried a brief item about Patrick Duggan, who, as the careful legal wording had it, was wanted in connection with alleged sex offences against children.
I came here, it would have been probably March time of 1976. The abuse would have started about 2 months later. It went up in stages. Didn't automatically start with buggery, it started with touching and making me touch him.
In 1997, there was an inquiry into child abuse at care homes in North Wales. During the proceedings, allegations were made about a man called Patrick Duggan, and that took the trail across the border to Hereford. Wessington Court was a school for what were called maladjusted boys from 8 to 13. The brochure for the school stated its aim was
to set a pattern for the children's lives within a framework of benevolent discipline. Above all, our purpose is to bring to the fore the normal responses of an ordinary child.
There was nothing normal about Wessington Court while Patrick Duggan was housemaster.
He always had a packet of sweets or a lolly, but you had to do sexual favours before you got them. He wanted sex, and that's why he worked here. It was his opportunity of having young boys.
All we had was his name, Patrick Duggan. We didn't know how we were going to trace him. We didn't know where he was.
I'm sorry everything's a bit of a jumble, but
I was able to trace the former owner and headmaster of the school, Mr. Dennis Eagles, who still lived locally.
Ah, here we are.
He provided some photographs of Patrick Duggan and two or three last known addresses in the London area.
Yes, we're going to have them. Hey, what order?
Any result from the PNC?
The name Patrick Duggan throws up too many responses. We need a date of birth.
That's all we've got.
It soon became evident that Patrick Duggan was not and had never been a local man to this area, and that if we were going to be fortunate enough to trace him, then we would need to go national.
What about Crime Watch? Well, maybe they'd show the photo.
Yeah. Give it a go.
All right.
The photo was taken 20 years ago. We decided that he needed to be aged somewhat, which is what we did, and we decided that it would be best to put the aged photo and the old photo on the programme.
This is an impression of how he might look now.
Pete, would you see to that?
Yeah, okay. All right. Right away.
Three. Did you see Crime Watch last night? He said there was a picture of my brother, Paddy, on it. Well, what did they want him for? My old man saw it, but he said he didn't hear exactly what for.
I'll find out for you.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, sure.
Ah, cheers.
Me and Paddy were like inseparable twins. We went everywhere together. He helped me bring my children up. He looked after my children for me. And for us to be that close, I can't understand how I never saw anything or knew anything.
After being alerted by Crime Watch, Maureen made the terrible discovery her own son had been abused.
I can tell you where Paddy is. He abused my Tommy. I want to kill him.
The response to the Crime Watch appeal was fantastic. We had many calls indicating the current whereabouts of Patrick Duggan. We even received a call from his own sister, who contacted her local police in London. And as a direct result of that call, Patrick Duggan was arrested within a few days of the Crime Watch appeal at an address in London.
And I wanted him taken away and locked up, and I never wanted him let out. I really wanted him to suffer for the suffer that he put my son through, and the pain and the torment, and I just had to get him picked up.
I hoped one day the truth would come out about this place. You always live in hope, but none of us kept in contact with each other. So for one to go and turn around and tell the police, I didn't think it would be any good. I didn't think they would believe me. So I never did. Obviously, I was wrong in that. Yeah, they did investigate.
The investigation then progressed, and my colleague and I began travelling the country, interviewing other victims that had contacted us as a direct result of the Crime Watch appeal.
Right. I've had a word with the reception. Apparently it's Queen's Way off Edgar Road.
This was the first time that I'd ever spoken about what happened here. The two CID officers knew that. And every time it got a bit hard in my statement, they would break. We would get a cup of tea, a cup of coffee, and have 10 minutes to myself. And then we would go back to where we were before.
Some of them found it impossible to actually speak the words about what had happened to them and were invited to write down what had actually happened to them.
The picture that emerged from the interviews conducted by Neil and Malcolm was of sustained abuse by Patrick Duggan.
Well, a lot of the time it used to happen in his room where he used to sleep. He used to come home, you know, at night time from the pub. He used to wake me up at night time. And he used to say, you're coming back to my room. You know, he used to, like, more or less force me to his room sort of thing.
Come on.
It didn't really matter what time of day or night time. If he wanted to abuse you, he'd abuse you. He didn't bother him at all.
What started as the story of one lone abuser soon developed into something worse. It emerged that a regime of brutality, fear and abuse could be traced right to the top.
As the investigation progressed and victims were naming the headmaster, Mr. Dennis Eagles, as a man who was also abusing boys at the school over a long period of time. At night time in the dormitory area, if any boy misbehaved, the victims were saying that every boy would be punished.
Eagles got the whole school up to stand in the hall. You were made to stand there till about 7 a.m. There was no going back to bed. If you moved a leg, if you moved a arm, if you did something while you were stood there, you would then get it in front of the whole school with a slipper or a ruler or whatever came to hand. I'm not talking about little taps across the legs at 8, 9-year-old. We're talking about major slaps, because every time they went to fall, they would get hit.
And this great charity.
This used to be Eagles' lounge. We didn't used to get sexually abused in a sense in this room, but what we did get was blankets, and he made sure that the lads abused each other.
Three boys couldn't stand it anymore and decided to run away.
We got quite a fair way. We were like pitch black. It was like, must have been 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, something like that. And that's when we got picked up by police. And then they brought us back here. And I don't know why, really. We didn't say anything to the police then. We should have done.
Stop there, boys. Hang on. Where are you lads off to?
They were basically being ruled by fear. And as a result of that, when they were abused, they made no complaint to anybody. They didn't believe anybody would listen to them. They didn't believe anything would be done about it.
Patrick Duggan was brought to trial in August 1998.
It was very emotional. We obviously felt for all of the victims who had each and every one been extremely brave to come to the court, to walk into the witness box, to face Duggan and relive the nightmare again.
When we went to arrest Dennis Eagles eventually, I think he had been waiting for that knock at the door, because obviously of our first approach to him, he must have realised that as the investigation went on, the allegations against him may come to light.
I can never forget what Patrick Duggan did to me. I can never forget what Dennis Eagles did to me. So therefore, I wanted them two to pay for what they've done for the whole of my life. Yeah, I don't just blame them for the 5 years in this school anymore. I blame them for me not being able to have a proper relationship.
They mustn't keep it to themselves, because like I say, it still does go on. Still does go on. And it does ruin people's lives.
I try not to think about it, but it's very hard. I'm like two different people. When I'm at work, I don't even think about it. When I come home, I hibernate in my bedroom, and then it all comes back to me again. My bedroom is like a prison to me.
The young lads who are now men like me have lives of near enough misery because of it. But they still don't have any guilt or remorse. They didn't at the trials, they didn't when they were abusing us. And I don't think they ever will.
Months ago, a murder made big news. A woman had been found dead at a university in central London. Elizabeth Stacey, a technician in the psychology department, had gone to work as usual on a Friday last November, Guy Fawkes Day.
Well, we found out on the Friday evening that she was missing. Hadn't turned up to meet her friend, and that was worrying because it's very unusual for Elizabeth. Somehow or other, I really knew in my heart of hearts, because you know, it's so unusual for her not to phone us, that something was very wrong.
Hello, how are you?
Not bad. Quite tired, I guess.
You worry too much. Don't let it get on top of you. Oh, before I forget, I need to speak to you about the website. I had a few problems with the server going down, so I might need to take the system offline. Would that be okay?
I'm in there all day, so any time is fine.
Hi, Jane. Can I have a word?
Actually, I've been working on this new web mod.
Stephen Reed was a postgraduate research student, and though he barely knew Elizabeth, she'd helped him on computer problems since she joined the staff 2 months earlier.
Freezing, this room. How are you getting on?
Well, not too bad.
Oh, this new software is causing all sorts of problems. Try clicking on this icon, yeah, and then into this file here, yeah. This is a favourite shortcut of mine. Works every time. Stephen, hi.
Hello.
How are you doing? All right?
Fine. Liz, I'm sorry to bother you, but I can't seem to open Windows on the computer in the postgrad lab. I was wondering if you wouldn't mind having a look.
Well, we've just finished up, haven't we, Gary?
Yeah, fine.
Yeah, okay. A couple of minutes. Right now?
Yeah, just that I can't really do anything unless... it's no bother.
Okay, okay. Let's go and have a look, shall we? See you later. Let's see what you've done on this computer. Okay, so it's this one, is it, Steve?
That's right.
Okay.
I kind of do a thing with it.
All right. Well, let's have a look. Well, seems to be okay. Mind you, these computers are always down all the time. Let me just try. Let's see what we've got in here.
DCI Ferguson. Hello, John.
The crime scene coordinator's on his way. It seems that the last person to see Miss Stacy was Stephen Reed, a fellow student. But since then, there's been no sign of him.
Well, all right, I'll see you soon.
OK.
The key things with all murders are to look at what evidence you've got available from the various scenes. I was concerned about what evidence we would be able to get from the room where Elizabeth was found.
Who had access?
A few people, including Reed.
What do we know about Reed?
He was a postgraduate student here at the university. A bit of a loner. Nobody seems to know very much about him. But the last time he was seen was in the company of Miss Stacy, here yesterday lunchtime.
Pathology?
On its way.
Witnesses?
Not that we know of.
Do we know the home address?
I got that from the university.
Good. Get over there quick. We might be lucky, might still be there. If he's not there, I want clues to where we might find him. Friends, relatives, OK?
Done.
Stephen Reed had vanished from the university at the same time. And either he was another victim of the offence, or alternatively, he was involved in the assault on her.
At the very least, he was going to be a significant witness to the inquiry. And getting hold of him at an early stage was obviously key to our investigation right from the start.
Detective Chief Inspector Guy Ferguson is leading the murder inquiry. He says they want to question 33-year-old Stephen Reed, one of her colleagues. He was the last person seen with her before she disappeared.
Investigating the murder of a research technician at the University of Westminster in London on Saturday afternoon. 24-year-old Elizabeth Stacy was found bludgeoned to death in a locked room at the university. Police said she had fought desperately for her life.
What do you think? Is Reed our man?
I don't know. He certainly seems to be favoured.
Dave has been on the phone from Edinburgh. He says he's been to see Reed's mother. There's been no sign of him.
Well, I think it's time to cast the net a little wider, don't you?
We had information that he used to go for long walks on Hampstead Heath. We also had information that he was fond of the West County, Cornwall in particular, and it was decided he could be anywhere in the UK. Somebody changes their name, doesn't seek employment, cuts himself off from the family, goes to an area of the country they're not associated with, and keeps a low profile. Obviously very difficult to find them.
I was concerned, that as time went on, that, Stephen might have tucked himself away somewhere where we'd never find him.
We start with the murder of the psychology technician Elizabeth Stacy and the disappearance of a university colleague. Research assistant Stephen Reed had asked her to help with a computer problem and he hasn't been seen since. Guy Ferguson is now looking for him. And Guy, according to the papers today, you're now really worried about Stephen himself and his well-being.
Hello, Incident Room Westminster.
Yeah, you saw him on holiday last summer in Greece. Thank you, madam, for your call.
Hello, is that the Crimewatch programme? That bloke you showed just now, I saw him today, I'm sure of it. Yeah, he was selling the big issue on the Western Road in Brighton.
There was no information or intelligence at all to suggest it would have been Brighton. That was a complete shock to us.
Some sightings in Cornwall, one in Edinburgh and one in Brighton. Yeah. I know, sounds promising to me, Gov. See you first thing in the morning.
I was going to relocate a load of officers down to the West Country to pursue the lines of inquiry that had been thrown up by the Crime Watch programme. And it was when we got the second call in from the CID at Brighton that I took the decision that, this was so promising that we really needed to bottom it out.
Are you Stephen Reed?
No, I'm Robbie Foster.
Well, I've got reason to believe that you're Stephen Reed. Therefore, I'm arresting you on suspicion of murder of Elizabeth Stacy.
I was absolutely delighted. It had been a very intense inquiry. To hear that they had got him sounded very, very promising, and so it was a real break.
Without Crimewatch's help, I don't think we'd have found him in Brighton. There were no leads to suggest he was there, no intelligence and no information.
without the general public's help, as always on these type of cases, we wouldn't have solved it in any way as quickly as we did.
His explanation was that he was a lonely man, he had no real friends, he felt that he wanted to commit suicide and that he didn't want to die alone. And he stated that Elizabeth was the nicest person that he knew and that he wanted to take her with him.
She was a very energetic, lively person and always made the most of everything she did. You sort of think maybe I'll wake up and it'll all be a dream, but it's not, so.
Pack your bags, we're going on holiday.
Hello, yes, DCI Cook speaking.
DC Underwood, Surrey Suite Selectors.
Go on.
There's been a robbery on a cash van in Godstone.
When did this happen?
6:30 tonight, sir. But we didn't realise up first how much was on board.
What did they get away with?
Well, the post office.
Godstone High Street. Right, meet me at the scene.
It starts off with you don't really know what you're going to. You know, all I've got is it's a serious robbery on a cash and transit vehicle. Historically, these are always difficult jobs to solve.
They were coming down here when suddenly a blue transit van pulls out from here and blocks them off.
Get out of the way!
The guy in the guard van tries to pull round, but before he can, a blue and white Luton comes up right behind him and boxes him in.
So I bit the horn, and the next thing I know, he's jumped out of the transit and wrapped the vehicle.
Don't do nothing!
I just froze.
What did he say?
He said,
don't move.
No alarms.
No mobiles.
Turn the engine off.
Don't worry, everything's fine.
Next thing is, somebody opens up the back of the van. Don't ask me how, there is no sign of any forced entry.
And the money was loaded into one of the vehicles, right?
Yes, sir.
Well, what do we know about the getaway vehicles?
Well, the blue van was ditched about half a mile away from here, where a witness saw somebody get into the white van, which then made off towards Gangers Lane.
Right, let's get up there.
This was clearly well-executed and well-planned crime, but we're looking for a starter for 10. We're looking for a few clues that we could actually latch an investigation onto.
Oh, hi, Angela. It's Stuart. Listen, can you do us a favour? Can you do us a PNC check on a white transit van, Delta 272 Papa Hotel Kilo?
No sign of it being forced. Needs to take special security keys.
So how did they get in?
Well, they must have had a duplicate key made up. No other way they could have got in. Someone's got hold of an original.
Right, what have we got?
I don't think either of the guards are involved, sir. They seem pretty straight.
What about the vehicles?
The blue and white Luton and the blue Transit are both registered to one Stephen Buttery.
I can't believe it's not Buttery, sir.
Shut up, Stuart.
Who? Buttery, Stephen Buttery. Or White, maybe. Some people know him as Stephen White.
Who wants to know?
DC Underwood, this is DC Mumford, Oxford CID.
No, it's no one of that name here, mate.
Yeah, right, OK.
Stephen Buttery was elusive, to say the least.
Morning. We're looking for a Stephen Buttery.
Don't know.
And we're
sorry.
Just wondering if... Thanks for your help. I mean, nothing is bad books as it is.
I don't believe it. How much did you put in the meter?
I didn't put anything in the meter. Stuart Underwood.
Stephen Buttery here. I understand you've been looking for me.
You're a difficult person to find, Mr. Buttery.
Yeah, well, I've been a bit busy, innit?
There's something we need to talk to you about, Mr. Buttery.
About what, exactly?
You're the registered keeper of two vehicles, a blue Transit E594VJH and a Luton Transit E158FRD.
I sold both of those end of Jan, beginning of Feb, somewhere around there.
Who to?
Some gypsy bloke. He paid cash, £3,000, I think. I've got the invoices somewhere, I'll show you, but I sort of wound a business up, you know, and I can't say for certain.
You haven't got an address for this gypsy guy, have you?
Well, no.
Well, can you describe him to us?
Well, he was sort of, you know, like a gypsy.
Not a lot to go on, is it? But if you didn't sell the vans, maybe he kept them outside his house or something.
And?
Well, I don't know. Maybe he got a ticket.
E158 FRD. It's dozens here. All for Senrab Street.
What's the next street?
Any for March?
Yep. Five.
I knew it.
Is there anything else we can do for you?
No, that is fantastic. Thank you. We'll take these. Actually, there is something. We got this morning. Five tickets, all issued after he said he sold the van and all within a couple of hundred yards of his house.
Excuse me. So now what?
Now the team needed more help from the public. The obvious choice was Crimewatch.
There was five men involved, possibly with these London accents, all white. We've got some good descriptions. They were hanging about in the Godston area for the week leading up to the robbery. We've got two good CD fits. The first is a white male with a hoodie.
I'm calling about the Godston job.
Yeah, about that robbery in Surrey. I've seen the van.
I know the man in the Gap top.
About the post office job. Man he wants going around selling TV stamps. His name's
Corley. John Corley.
And how will he be paying today?
Cash.
Thank you.
It's never been released that TV stamps were on that van, has it?
No. Call's got to be genuine. He's got previous for our robbery. The Met are looking at him for another job. I think we should bring him in.
We actually found out that he was there in the West Country. So some officers went down to the hotel he was in.
John Corley, I'm arresting you on suspicion of conspiracy to commit robbery.
We had another search team and some other officers went to his home address, and that's when I would think the word Eureka springs to mind. Criminals themselves become complacent, and he obviously thought that it was a way of earning money through selling some of this stuff. It was a surprise to us, it was a pleasant surprise, and I've got to say we're eternally grateful for his sloppiness.
Mr. Underwood?
As much as we're excited at the find of the postage stamps, the search officer from Essex went one further.
Dave?
We were covered. Three keys, one of which fitted the cash in transit vehicle.
Well. If it isn't the security keys to the van.
Mr. Underwood?
Yeah.
Can you come inside a minute?
Yeah.
Stuart?
Hello, sir.
Have you found anything interesting yet?
You could say that, sir, yeah. Three post office security keys buried in the garden.
You're pulling my leg.
Not to mention a wardrobe full of stamps and several pieces of paper lined about the place with phone numbers on, several of which we think we're going to find on the phone bill of a certain Stephen Buttery. Stephen Buttery, I'm arresting you on suspicion of conspiracy to commit robbery.
These people believe they're untouchable. And, you know, when the truth comes home to them and the fact that they're not, it does bring these people down to earth.
Sometimes police come to us with an appeal at the early stages of an investigation, but in others, like this next case, they've put together a complex case already. They just need to find that one last piece to finish the jigsaw.
Front clear.
This is the story of a police raid that led to an arrest and uncovered a trail which would lead detectives round the world in search of the other half of a major drugs deal. Gavin Dole was picked up following a persuasive tip-off that he was trafficking in drugs. Detectives had a search warrant, but as yet no evidence against him.
Hello?
Red Benny.
There's a load of cash in here as well, look. Is this your money?
No, just mind it.
Bingo.
Right. Gavin, what's this stuff in the fridge?
Dunno.
Is it yours?
No.
Gavin Doe, I'm arresting you on suspicion of possession of drugs with intent to supply. You do not have to say anything, but it may harm your defence if you choose not to mention when questioned something which you later rely on in court. Anything you do say may be given in evidence.
Paul? Come on, have a look at this, mate.
All right, Gav. Sorry I haven't rang. Firstly, I could only get four of those packets up me, so the rest are in our fill. Get his mobile number off Jackie and give him a ring. So you should post the next lot of gear out of me leather jacket. You'll hear from me soon with an address. All the best, Mark.
All the best, Mark? Who the hell's Mark?
There were good clues, phone numbers.
They all begin 00612.
With the Australian dialing code.
Excellent, I'll send you a postcard from Bondi Beach.
Listen, Dream, forget Bondi Beach. You're supposed to be in boot right now, aren't you?
Yeah.
Give us a ring from the lab, yeah?
Will do. But I bet you get to Australia, though. What have we got, Dave?
963 grams of amphetamine sulfate.
How pure is it?
Pretty pure. It's 26%. The purest amphetamine would have, like, 30%.
Excellent. Cheers, mate.
Street drugs are heavily adulterated to make them go further. So if this amphetamine was pure, the police were close to the source of original supply. But what was the link with Australia? And who was the mysterious Mark, the author of the letter?
Is there anything else?
Yeah, we got a print on it. It's for a William John Anthony Pimblett, wanted for perverting the course of justice as Mark Pimblett. And the same Mark Pimblett as previous for conspiracies to steal and failing a breathalyzer.
Listen, Pete, Mark Pimblett must have written that letter. And I think Gavin's in it even deeper than we thought.
Do you reckon he's export?
Sounds like it, from the letter. It sounds like it's to Australia. Chloe's checking with the immigration board, see if he hasn't been in and out of there. Right, Gavin. Who do you know called Mark? There's a few numbers in that file of facts of yours, Gavin, for Australia. One of them is for Mark Pimblett. Ring any bells?
No comments.
So we know he was in Australia, then?
Well, I called the immigration department and they say that Mark Pimblett, or at least someone travelling on his passport, has been in and out of Australia the last few weeks.
What about the phone calls?
Well, we've got Gavin's bills and the only calls down under are when Mr Pimblett's out there.
And what are the Aussies doing?
Well, the federal police are trying to sort it all out. They're getting in touch with the phone company to check the records and make sure everything's all right.
Nice.
With the last known contact numbers for Mark Pimblett in Australia, officers went out to find him. Police in Sydney offered help, but it was up to the British detectives to check out addresses and trek round what might have been Pimblett's haunts.
Could you have a look at that for me? Tell me if you've seen him around at all.
No, mate.
No? No. Don't remember him at all, no. All right, thanks very much anyway.
It seemed he wasn't in Australia now, but the detectives quickly proved he had been there repeatedly.
Yeah, I've got the immigration cards.
Yeah.
Yeah, listen, I've got all the itemised bills showing the calls to Gavin's place. And I've got statements. Yeah, statements from the people Gavin stayed with. No, he's definitely back now, boss. He's definitely going to be back in England.
But where? The obvious starting point was Pimblett's family home.
Right. There's Mrs. P.
Let's go.
Excuse me. Excuse me.
Yeah?
Are you Mrs. Pimblett?
Yeah. I wonder if you can help us. We're looking for your husband, Mark.
Not with him anymore. I haven't seen him for months, so sorry I can't help.
Daddy coming home.
You get upstairs.
Time was running out. They needed more evidence to prove conspiracy.
We can't keep Gavin on remand any longer. He's going to get bail.
Then out of the blue, a tip-off.
Mark Pimblett on the London train.
Now.
He's on his way to London. You phone Houston and get in touch with the BTP. Now.
I'll fax a photo through.
You. I think it's covered for any of the stations in between.
Will do, Peter.
Thank you.
But at London Euston, Mark slipped through the net. The police had one last stab at tracing him.
And maybe you know this man, Mark Pimblett. Though sometimes he uses other names, including William John Anthony Pimblett.
Hello, I'm calling about Mark Pimblett. I think he's staying at a flat in Muriel Street, King's Cross, number 11. No, I won't leave my name.
Which number did he say it was?
It's that one up there on the top floor.
That's him.
Is it?
That's him. Yeah, that's Pim all day.
Right.
What? All right, Mark. We're looking everywhere for you, mate. Mark Pimblett, I'm arresting you for conspiracy to export drugs. Tell you what, Mark, you wouldn't believe what I've been looking for you, mate.
After 12,000 miles and 15 months, it had taken a single phone call to locate him.
Football is big business. It's sold as a clash between gladiators, and some fans take that as a call to arms. For the police, it's a major operation. They monitor the fans before and after the event, and where they can, they pursue the violent ones to court. One expected flashpoint was last year's visit of South London's Millwall to Manchester City. 220 officers were deployed, including mounted police, a helicopter and a riot squad.
There was intelligence that a large number of people would be travelling and some of those would be intent on causing violence.
Among the 2,000 fans who went to Manchester were Liam Slack, Neil Eccleston and Paul Gaynor.
India 2629, could you show state zero, please, over the city ground, looking for city fans?
Aggression in the stands is so acute that fans have to be segregated, though some football clubs do this better than others. At Manchester City, City supporters are seated right beside rows of visiting fans, with the police expected to keep order.
Right. This guy here, now I've picked him out as one of the targets and I want him monitored through all four videos.
The day after the match, and the papers have been full of yesterday's violence, 11 officers are among those injured. Some of the troublemakers were appearing on the police tapes again and again.
At that point, we had no idea who these people were or where they came from. It was more or less looking for a needle in a haystack, pinpointing these people.
There he is.
Yeah.
Well, that was the result.
Keeping the heat on the soccer hooligans, Greater Manchester Police liaised with the Met and with NSIS, the National Criminal Intelligence Service. Together, they identified 5 men. But that left 7.
We'd reached a dead end and we approached Crimewatch in the hope that an appeal on the programme would lead to being able to put names to faces.
We want to identify 7 faces in particular. Generally, matches are widely covered by broadcasters and...
We got a great response from the public. We got in the region of 80 to 100 calls.
Is that Crimewatch? Yeah, that guy with a cap on the telly. I know his name. Yeah, and I know where he lives.
Right, Neil. Saw you on Crimewatch last night.
Did you?
Don't worry, what job are you in? I can lend you the video if you like.
Recognise any of these men, 0500 600 600, or you can call the incident room on 0161 856 4...
Operation Antigua, DS Reed, how can I help you?
Hello, yeah, I'm phoning about the Crimewatch programme.
My name's Neil Eccleston.
Right, OK, Neil, what's your date of birth?
Once we'd identified all the targets through police sources and the appeal on Crimewatch, I travelled to London and we coordinated the arrests. Some people came to the police station willingly, others we had to send out teams of officers to arrest them at home.
Paul Gaynor, I'm arresting you under suspicion of violent disorder. You do not have to say anything, but it may harm your defence if you do not mention when questioned something which you may later rely on in court. Do you understand?
I went to arrest Liam Slack with London officers and discovered that he'd only just recently moved out. As a result of that, our inquiries came to a dead end and we circulated him as wanted on the police national computer.
3 months later, he was seen acting suspiciously in a London street and was stopped by chance.
Right, we've had a call to you. All right, hanging around motor vehicles.
Liam Slack was stopped in the street a few months after we travelled to London.
412, go ahead.
Yes, if you'd just like to listen to what these officers have got to say.
Right, Sarge, this chap's been arrested for being wanted on warrant in Manchester for a violent disorder.
Once we'd identified Liam Slack, we recognised him as somebody we had photographs of in our intelligence unit at Lewisham Police Station. We returned to the station and looked through our own files and found out that he was, he'd been ejected on a few occasions from Millwall Football Club for minor disorder.
I'm not hanging about.
Holiday for you, is it?
Liam Slack was charged and released on bail and failed to attend at the Magistrates' Court here in Manchester.
Somewhere sunny.
The police had failed to find Liam and we approached Crimewatch for a reappeal as to where he was living. The day following the Crimewatch appeal, Liam walked into a police station and handed himself in.
My name's Liam Slack.
This was the last major game of the season for Millwall, and it was clear that it was going to be a flashpoint match. A majority of the people that travelled that day didn't come intent on causing violence or trouble.
All right, Neil. Did you throw anything?
Not that I can remember, but if I have, you'll tell me.
Did you throw something?
No.
Did you throw anything at any time?
Not that I can remember. I need to be shown if I have.
All right, Neil. Have a look at that. Now tell me, what do you do there?
I didn't throw anything there. I didn't throw anything.
We'll be back with more appeals next month. Join us on Wednesday, the 6th of September.
Together, we really do make a difference, so don't have nightmares, do sleep well. Good night.
Good night.
If you can help on any crime, you can call Crime Stoppers anonymously if you want, 0800 555 111. And if you've been a victim of a crime and want to talk to someone, call Victim Support on 0845 30 30 900.